Classic Thematic Review, Consequences of Industrialization, circa 1750 to 1900. So we're doing a thematic organization here. So here are those themes that we'll be focusing on that we've seen in previous sections. And our essential question says, what was the relative significance of the effects of imperialism from 1750 to 1900? So again, this keyword effect should make you think of a causation question. And it is specifically focusing on the effects, so we'll be analyzing those, but we're going to spend some time looking at the causes of imperialism also, just because it's such a pivotal moment in world history. So an overview of the unit, the way it's organized. First, let's start with the definition of imperialism. During the time period roughly 1750 to 1900, and it did extend after 1900, but 1900 is when Unit 6 ends, European powers created a system of global colonies. And this map, which maybe is a little hard to see, shows it with the colors by country. So you might be able to tell that green, which is Britain, is a dominant color. There's a lot of green stuff here. There's also a lot of this purple color, which is France. They've got colonies in West Africa here, over here in Southeast Asia. We have the Dutch in Indonesia, also known as the Dutch East Indies, and some other powers in Africa and other parts of Asia. So we'll start off by looking at imperialism. So these first three chapters really focus on the causes and effects of imperialism. And then we look at the development of a global economy in 4 and 5. And in 6 and 7, we'll look at the causes and effects of labor migration. So remember, there are other videos that go over these chapters one at a time. And you can also watch a chapter-organized review of Unit 6. So starting with the social theme, we'll look at class structures and the effect of imperialism on those class structures. So Europeans are conquering much of Africa and Asia, and when they do that, they're creating new social structures with Europeans at the top of the social pyramid. So in India, for instance, the British place themselves at the top of this pyramid and supplant the Indian elites that had been there before British conquest. And if you might remember in our previous unit, when we looked at European colonies in the Americas, the Spanish created a similar system of social hierarchy in which Europeans were at the top of the pyramid. The second social effect we'll look at is the effects of this labor migration, shown here on this map, on home society. So we see here that there's a lot of people moving around the world. This red arrow represents Europeans moving to places. We have slavery and other forms of coerced labor from Africa. We have a lot of Indian migration. And so when that happens, most of these migrants are male, which means the women left behind have increasing responsibility both in and out of the home. Women often worked in those societies. Some of them received money sent home from the migrant worker, and they had responsibility for how that money was spent. So overall, in these home societies, this creates more autonomy and status for women and changes the social structure and weakens the patriarchy that had been prevalent in so many societies before this time. So now's a good time to stop and review the social theme and look at how labor migration changed social structures around the world. So we'll focus on that second half of the previous slide. Now we'll turn our attention to the political theme and the causes of imperialism. And the first essential cause is European nationalism, that there is a race for colonies, largely sparked by the fact that after 1800, remember from a previous unit, the revolutions that swept the Americas, the American Revolution, the Haitian, the Creole revolutions, and the Latin American colonies, created a vacuum in this mercantilism system of resources to fuel the economies of the European powers. And so that loss is creating a need for more resources and a need for more colonies. So the scramble for Africa is an example of that. You can see all these colors in Africa here are reminding us of how many different powers were competing with each other. And so European nationalism, a desire to defeat your enemy, to be more stronger than your rival, such as France and Germany, which had a long-standing rivalry in Europe, and they had a disagreement over Morocco, among other places. And that is not limited only to European powers. China and Japan have conflict in Asia. Japan and Russia fight a war called the Russo-Japanese War. So that theme of nationalism, which we looked at in the last unit, is really important here in sparking European imperialism. The other phenomenon we get is a shift from private to state control in some of these colonies. So you might remember the British and Dutch East India companies from previous units. Going all the way back to the 16 or 1700s, these were private companies that dominated trade in those regions. And what happens during this time period is control is turned over from the private company to the European power itself. So in India, for instance, the British government directly administers that colony. In Belgium, the colony was originally technically owned by King Leopold, and that's in the Belgian Congo here, right in the middle of Africa. And it is turned over during this time period to the Belgian government, largely due to the atrocities that happened there. So the big picture politically is the expansion of these empires by conquest. So we've talked about the Europeans in Africa. We have the British conquering India. We have the Opium Wars, which creates spheres of influence and some control for European powers over trade in China. We have the Dutch right here, some British colonies such as Burma or modern-day Myanmar. We have Indochina or modern-day Vietnam and Laos under French control. And we have the U.S. expanding and annexing Hawaii and the Philippines. And then the other phenomenon we have, in addition to colonies created by conquest, is we have what we call settler colonies. And these are colonies in which Europeans move there and colonize directly. And Australia and New Zealand are two examples of those types of colonies in which, rather than conquering Australia, it was largely due to an expansion of people moving there. So that was sort of the causes of imperialism, and now we'll look at some of those political effects. And the first is that there is, in many cases, resistance by indigenous people, or people who live in the areas that are being conquered or expanded into. And we can think about an external resistance, which is resisting a foreign power, and a nationalism-inspired resistance to an empire that's more local. So some examples of external resistance would be a revolution in the Philippines against both Spanish and later American control, the resistance led by Samori Toure in West Africa, the Indian Rebellion of 1857 against British control, and the Maori Wars against the British in New Zealand. Now, these are explained in more detail in another chapter, and there are other examples of resistance. These are just some of them. We also have resisting expansion of states. So as the American government expanded its territory to the West, the Ghost Dance in the American Southwest was a resistance movement of Native Americans. And in the Ottoman Empire, which is shrinking during this time period, we have the Greek War of Independence. And again, these are inspired by some form of nationalism or an effort to have cultural supremacy. So as far as political review, we can look at the political causes and effects of imperialism during this time period. Next, we'll move over to the environmental theme and the interaction between humans and the environment. And we're going to focus on that second big topic here, which is the development of a global economy, which is, remember, a phenomenon that begins as far back as the 1600s with the global silver trade and the arrival of Europeans on Asian trading networks, and of course has continued throughout the centuries to the present day. So we'll look at the fact that some environmental factors contributed to that global economic system, and one of them is the climate making cash crop agriculture possible and in high demand. So there were some high demand products in this time period, such as cotton, rubber, palm oil, that grow in tropical areas. So in Europe, these crops do not grow. So cotton, for instance, is native to places like Egypt and India. So there's a big demand to create control over those regions so that you can manage and profit from the trade. Guano, which is bird or bat droppings, was a very lucrative form of fertilizer in primarily Latin America. Another example of environmental factors are the fact that some of these colonies had rich mineral deposits, such as silver, copper, and diamonds. Here is a diamond mine in South Africa. And of course, that could make colonizing powers very wealthy. And the next feature we have environmentally is that some environmental issues encouraged or caused migration. So poverty and famine in places like India, China, and Ireland are in some cases due to environmental factors, such as the Irish potato famine, which was an environmental disaster for the potato crop and encouraged some Europeans to leave Ireland and move to places like the United States. So what we'll do here with the environmental theme is, again, look at how environmental factors contributed to the development of a global economy. When you see this word contributed to, that's a good clue that you're talking about causes. So in this case, what caused the development of a global economy? But we're directed to focus on environmental factors. Moving on to the cultural theme, we'll look at the cultural causes of imperialism. So in this section here, we're kind of coming from the European and colonial power standpoint. And a big cultural cause was a racist and pseudoscientific belief that European culture was superior. So there were scientists who claimed that Europeans were a superior culture. And of course, we now know that that isn't true, but it was one of the things that encouraged this colonization because Europeans believed that it was their responsibility to spread their superior culture to people who had not been exposed to it. Social Darwinism is this idea of taking the Darwinian survival of the fittest natural selection model of biology and applying it to human society, which was interpreted as justification for the weak dominating the strong. And one thing that's important to remember that's kind of hovering over this era of imperialism is that the countries doing the conquering have industrialized, and we have conflicts which are industrialized powers versus non-industrialized powers. And of course, it's very difficult for a non-industrialized military to resist an industrialized one. And that's one of the things that contributes to the European myth of being superior because of their industrial might. Another cultural reason is the desire of Christian missionaries to spread their religion. And the success of that is shown in this map here. The dark pink are areas in modern times in which the population is over 50% Christian. And in the lighter color, it's 10 to 50% Christian. So you can see that some of those areas we talked about, especially sub-Saharan Africa, and of course the Americas, which is a legacy of Spanish conquest, and even some areas in Asia, and of course Australia and New Zealand, is a legacy of European control. The next thing we'll look at is a resistance to imperialism that instead of motivated by political nationalism, it is motivated by cultural factors. So in South Africa, there was a Xhosa cattle killing movement, which was based on a religious belief that the world was ending and that it was the responsibility of people who lived there to resist European conquest. We also have a religious movement to establish the Sokoto Caliphate in West Africa. Remember, a caliphate is a state that is based on Islamic law, and that would be right here in modern-day West Africa. And over in the Sudan, in this part of Africa, we have modest states, which are also the effort to create Islamic states. So again, some of that resistance is more cultural than political, but it's the same idea. Next, we'll look at the cultural effects of migration, starting with the creation of ethnic enclaves, which are neighborhoods or parts of cities in which migrants from a home country, such as from China, move and relocate to a city for work or for labor and live in the same neighborhood. And so you're probably familiar with neighborhoods like Chinatown. There's one in San Diego called Little Italy. We have an example here of Little India in Singapore. And so there's quite a bit of migration patterns that happen, such as Chinese migrants relocating to Southeast Asia, the Caribbean, and the Americas. This map here shows Chinese migration throughout Southeast Asia. We have Indian migrants in South Africa, Southeast Asia, and the Caribbean, and the Irish in North America. And of course, those ethnic enclaves have an influence on the culture of those home countries. In some cases, there is a negative reaction to that ethnic influence, and we have a resistance to the cultural influence of migrants. And two examples are in the United States, the Chinese Exclusion Act, which forbade Chinese immigration to America for a period of time, and a long-running policy in Australia called the White Australia Policy, which attempted to preserve more of a European cultural influence in Australia. So now's a good time to stop and look at the extent to which cultural traditions and attitudes affected the development of imperialism. So we'll focus on effects, but we'll look at how extensive those cultural effects were on the way that imperialism developed. Next, we'll look at the economic theme, and we'll be focusing first on the economic causes of imperialism. And we're going to look at two kinds of imperialism, what we could call political imperialism, although usually what we mean by political imperialism is simply stated as imperialism. And then we're going to look at something called economic imperialism, which is slightly different. So to go back to that trend of Europeans conquering much of Africa and Asia, from an economic standpoint, they're motivated by a desire for new resources to fuel their industrial factories. So we talked about cotton and rubber, for instance. They're motivated by a desire for cheap labor, especially because in European factories, during the 19th century, the labor movement creates better conditions for workers, and so labor costs go up for factory owners, and new markets or new places to sell their products. These are all about economic expansion. These are about expanding industrial economies. So here's an example of that that shows cotton exports from India, Egypt, and Brazil, and it's hard to see, but the numbers go up dramatically. It's 346 million pounds in 1860. And 803 only 6 years later. So that's almost a tripling in 6 years. Economic imperialism is when a foreign business has significant influence over the local economy. And so it's not a direct political conquest. You're not conquering and creating a new system of laws, but your government is having, essentially controlling the economy of another country. So cash crop agriculture is a part of economic imperialism in which you have extremely beneficial trade advantages to get these raw materials. Some examples of that control over local economies includes the opium wars in China and the fact that Western powers could control the trade there. The fact that some powers, such as the British and Argentina, invested in industrial infrastructure, such as ports. And we have this phenomenon we call banana republics. The United Fruit Company was an American company that had extremely significant influence over the economies of Latin America. And all of this results for the European power that is doing the controlling in higher profits and a competitive advantage with their economic rivals. Next, we'll look at the economic causes of migration. So we have, during this time period, labor migration, in which workers relocate, either permanently or temporarily, for work in this increasingly globalized economy. And in some cases, that is a voluntary migration. There are job opportunities to be had. Perhaps you've lost your job in your home country and you have a job opportunity somewhere else. So you might know that people moved to America for work during the expansion of the United States, and that happens throughout the world. So European immigrants to American factories, that would be shown in this era right here, is an example of that. But we also have during this time period a phenomenon continuing of coerced or semi-coerced labor. Slavery is abolished in most of the world during the 19th century, really by the mid-19th century, although it persists in Brazil until later in the 19th century. But it is replaced largely as we get into the later 19th and into the 20th centuries with other forms of coerced or semi-coerced labor, such as indentured servitude. This is where a worker essentially borrows money to make this migration journey to pay passage, and they have to pay off that passage. But the conditions under which they do that are very poor, and it really is a form of labor exploitation. Some Asian people had a similar phenomenon of contract labor, in which you have to pay off the contract in your new location. And then we have prison colonies. In Australia and New Zealand were formed of prison colonies, and typically those were prisoners who were in jail because of debt. So it was a way to pay off your debt. So there's usually, with this coerced or semi-coerced labor, an economic element to it in which you are paying back a loan, but the terms of that repayment are not beneficial to the worker. So now we can stop and look at the economic causes and effects of imperialism. So what you'll be doing in this video when you answer these questions is answer a similar question, like causes and effects of imperialism, from different thematic perspectives. Our last theme is technology, and we'll look at how it contributed to the development of a global economy. So we have some technology that's going to facilitate the movement of goods and people, both of which are important for the economy to become more global and spread across greater distances. So some transportation technology that made that possible were the steam engine, which initially is powering factories only, but is eventually used to power railroads and steamships, which of course are a more efficient and cheaper way to move goods to new markets, which make it possible for a factory, let's say, to expand its business because they can get their products to more places. These same technologies, in addition to transporting goods, transport people and facilitate the movement of people with this labor migration. So the big arrows we're seeing here are primarily, especially the ones going across the oceans, on steamships. Next, we have the communication technology in the 19th century of the telegraph, which made near-instant communication possible. So if you're going to have an increasingly global economy, if you're going to have a British company managing cotton exports from India and from Egypt, it really helps to have direct instant communication to facilitate those business transactions. And so both of those technologies make this global economy possible. So we can stop and look at, again, how technological developments caused the development of a global economy. So those are our themes. Here's a timeline just to remind you that these things are happening kind of all at the same time. So here's an example of that nationalist resistance to the expansion of empires. And shortly thereafter, we have the propeller-driven steamship, which makes the transportation of goods possible. We have imperialism really picking up with the scramble for Africa. We have the investment in the port in Argentina. So just kind of be aware that even though we sometimes separate things by theme or by chapter, it's important to pay attention to the dates and how they're happening, in many cases, over in overlapping phenomena. It's not like chapter 6.1 happened first, then 6.2, then 6.3. So our essential question, we talked about this, focused on the effects of imperialism, but we're going to first look at the causes, just as a way to review that first significant development in this unit. And so we can think of primarily political, economic, and cultural causes. So the main political cause had to do with that competition and that nationalism and desire to make sure that you're more influential, that idea of an industrialized military. And remember, we have the shift from private to state control and settler colonies. Then we have that sort of industrialization basis for imperialism, trying to get raw materials for factories, new markets for your products. The environmental cause is kind of in there with the cash crop agriculture. And then we had that racist belief, that social Darwinism, but also the Christian missionary activity, all of which caused imperialism to happen. But our essential question focused on the effects of imperialism. So here's all those themes kind of running around together. So a main effect of imperialism long term is the development of a global economy. And so what you're doing there is producing goods in non-industrialized countries for the profit of industrialized countries. And I kind of squeeze an environmental theme in here about the climate facilitating certain crops and cash crop agriculture and the location of mines. So we have increasing global trade as an effect of imperialism. We also have that idea of economic imperialism and those banana republics and the fact that there are countries exploiting the economies of other places for profit. And another big effect is labor migration. And we talked about those different types, coerced, semi-coerced, and voluntary. And the fact that that movement was facilitated by technology, which made it possible to move people and goods and to communicate more efficiently. We also talked about the social structures changing, especially in the case of migration, and that was in 6.7, that women have more responsibility when they stay home after men are migrating. We have the creation of those ethnic enclaves due to migration, and some political effects were resistance to imperialism, either politically inspired with nationalism or inspired by religion. And remember, that's just a quick overview. If you go back to individual chapters, you can get more specific details about those themes. And hopefully that was helpful for you to review with a thematic focus this critical development in world history of imperialism and the globalization of economic activity. That's your Unit 6 thematic overview. Studying!